Hello everyone, thank you very much for watching this live event. We continue today our discussion on software deployment with containerization. We'll discuss and apply with a hands-on example Docker, so that you will have a T-shaped overview from the software developer and software architecture point of view of what containers are. You are watching the event live, don't forget that you have a live chat there so you can watch, so you can write your questions and start discussions in the live chat. If you are watching the event afterwards, you can still ask questions in the comment section, and don't forget that you can join me on Twitter and LinkedIn as well. So follow me to know when I'm speaking participate in other events as well. As I said, we continue the discussion we started last week in the previous episode, in which we discussed the abstraction layers of deployment, and you have seen that you can deploy your application directly on a machine, which is the less abstract deployment layer, but that gives you the best flexibility, or you can go more abstract by deploying it in a virtual machine, or you can go even more abstract that you can deploy it in a container, or you can even use serverless. And the more abstract you go, so the more upper in the abstraction stack you go, the easier it is to deploy, of course, but the less possibility, the less flexibility you have in the deployment. And remember my analogy with the pizza delivery from last time. I won't repeat what we already discussed, so in case you missed the previous episode, don't forget that you can rewatch it anytime on this same channel. That will always be free with all its content. And what I plan to discuss today is start a discussion on what containers are and make a comparison between containers, what we discuss now, and apply with virtual machines, and then based on our discussion decide which is the relationship between the deployment layers, the containerization versus infrastructure directly, which means virtual machines, to what kind of architecture, software architecture deploy, what kind of software you deploy based on this the abstraction layer you choose. And it's very important to understand this subject, because not only that people start to sometimes make confusions considering that a better abstraction means a better way of deployment, like containers are better than the virtual machine, which is not true. Not necessarily true. It might be depending on what your application is and how your system looks like. Or serverless is better than containers and is better than the virtual machine, which is again not true. So it really depends what we choose. And it's very often that in systems you have to make a combination. You have to use also virtual machines combined with containers, combined with serverless functions as a service, backend as a service, whatever we discussed in the previous lesson. So yeah, remember that the abstraction, a better abstraction doesn't necessarily mean a better way of deployment. And of course, with what we discuss here in this episode and in the next episodes, I hope that you will have this overview, or at least I will manage to build you a better overview on what these deployment layers mean and how to link them to your application, to your system. But for that, we need to, of course, discuss it in a bit more detail and even apply it. So in this episode, we start about discussing about containers. So again, remember that always you need something to deploy on. So when we discuss containers, is not something that is standalone. It always relies on having something behind, which is either a virtual machine or a bare metal, but you need to install your containers into something. So you can't simply have containers and that's it. Even when we discuss about cloud, you will have some kind of infrastructure, you will have some kind of virtual machines in which you install your container orchestration. And that's basically what we will also do. So when we say we have containers, you basically also have virtual machines, most likely. Of course, you can install your containers on bare metal, like for example, what we'll do here, because I won't use a virtual machine now. I will simply install and use Docker on my computer. But you still depend on something behind the scenes. So this is my containers, and this is basically where we will use Docker as the solution for creating the containers. And behind the scenes, you have a virtual machine on which Docker is running. So the rectangle below is either a VM, like in most cases in a real life example, you use a virtual machine here, or you can even have it, as I said, bare metal, like what happens in case you study Docker and you install it directly on your machine. But let's say we have a virtual machine here, okay? And the difference is that, as you will see, when using Docker, first of all, we create an image, and this image is the definition of whatever you would like to install over your virtual machine. And as you will see, you will not have only one image, but in case of Docker, when you create this kind of a deployment, Docker is a smart tool that uses layered images, which means that whenever you create an image, you create it based on another one that might be created based on another one that might be created based on another one. But before going deeper into images, I would like first to make you aware of what actually a container is, and what an image is, and how you create an image, and we will also apply this. But what I observed is that very often developers or people that start with Docker find it difficult to understand the relationship between what a container is in Docker, what an image is in Docker, what a Docker file is. These are three very important elements you need to remember when discussing containers. So the Docker file, the image, and the container. And to make you an analogy, because you are most likely Java developers, so all of you, or maybe only some of you, but you most likely understand an object-oriented language already, or at least I suppose that. And just take it as an example. You already know in Java, maybe, or a similar language, what a class is, what an object is, and what the instance is. So you know that when I write a class, like I write the class cat, which is one of my favorite examples, and I just say public class cat, and I open the curly braces, and then I write the attributes and the methods of the class. What I'm writing there is a Java file in which I directly write the source code, isn't it? So that source code file that has the Java extension is for a Java application what the Docker file is for Docker. Now, when you compile, you obtain the bytecode, which is basically, you can just imagine or think about it as being the object you defined using the language. And that is what, in analogy with Docker, you can consider to be the image. And then you know what you do with an object that you designed with a class, which is the blueprint. You create instances. How many instances can you create? An infinity, whatever, you don't have a limitation of it. We're using a class, an object defined with a class, you can create as many instances as you want with that class. So that instance, as an analogy, is what you will see in Docker as being the container. The container is the instance of Docker. You can create as many containers as you want, start as many containers as you want based on an image. So it's basically like you write a source file in Java to create and to define an object, and then with the object, which is the prototype, you create as many instances. The same in Docker you do when you write a Docker file, That Dockerfile tells how the environment looks like in Docker, because in Docker we discuss about deployments. So what we implement with Docker is environments. You write a Dockerfile to define how the environment looks like in your perspective. You create based on the Dockerfile the image, and then the image you can use to spin up as many containers as you'd like. Same as in your Java program, you write a class to create an object to create instances. So first of all, I would like to make sure that you understand this chain of things that happen when you deploy a container, to make sure that you understand the difference between what a container is. The container is the real environment running. It's a spinned up environment in which an application is running, or even more applications can be running there. So when you say container, that's something running, that's an environment, an existing environment. When you say an image in Docker, that's something that describes the container that will be spinned up. It's like a blueprint of the containers that can be spinned up, and you can spin up an infinite number of containers, an unlimited number. The only limitation you have is, like in case of Java, the memory and the resources of the system. In general, but having the image, you have no limitations on how many containers you spin up based on the same image. And in order to describe that image, in order to create the image based on which you spin up environments, you spin up containers, you write a Dockerfile. So that's the relationship, and that's what we do in Docker. In Docker, you create the final, the purpose is creating that container, which is the running environment. To create that container, which is a running environment over a virtual machine, you have to define how the environment looks like, and that's the image. It's called image because it's basically picturing the environment you will spin up. And in order to create, to actually define that, you use descriptive language in a Dockerfile. And basically the abstraction that comes with a containerized environment is that now you basically only define the application and whatever comes above the virtual machine, so that you can abstract only that piece of environment that is over the operating system, which relies now on the virtual machine side. So now, if you want to imagine that even better, just think about what will happen if you want to directly install an application on bare metal or a virtual machine, which is the same thing. You will have the virtual machine with an operating system, so you have a Linux-based virtual machine, and then you enter, you log in that virtual machine, and you have to spin up your application using a command, like say it is a Java application, you will run Java minus jar and then the name of the jar, and you will have to define other several configurations if needed. Imagine that you, in case of containers, you keep the virtual machine and take all this installation of the application together with any configuration the application needs as a separate layer, so that you always have a virtual machine which is clean, and in case you want to upgrade something, you don't have to upgrade everything, like the whole virtual machine, but only that small piece of information of the environment that makes it different. And that's really a really good improvement, because instead of having now to keep a full image of the virtual machine with everything that's installed on it, you only have a smaller footprint representing only with what is above the virtual machine. And secondly, being smaller, you can more easily drop that environment and recreate it. And that's very important. It's very, very usable, especially when you have microservices architectures, because that's where you have small applications and applications that start fast, that are small in footprint and also start fast, and putting them in a container, you can, instead of managing the application, now directly manage the container, which you will see through Docker is very easy. it's spinning up a new container, like if you want to replicate and have the application running multiple times, or restarting a container because the application stuck, it becomes more easy than managing the application itself. Okay, but now, in order to have a better idea, I would like to start coding, because I know using visual and telling stories makes one part of the thing, but people and developers usually make an even better idea of how things work by seeing them in practice. So I would like now, together with you, create a very small Java application and spin it up in a containerized environment using Docker. And then come back to our visual and try to understand what happened based on our practical example and with the visual. Theoretically, I hope you will at the end have a clear big picture of what containers are, so that we can then comment and make a comparison between containers and virtual machines and software architectures. To be able to implement that for you, so what I did first, I installed Docker, which is pretty simple to install it in mostly any environment. So if you have any Windows, Mac, or Linux machine, you can simply just download and install Docker from the official site, so from here. And what you basically need to know afterwards is that together with Docker, you will need to have access to the Docker Hub. So I do recommend you create an account which is free in Docker Hub, and I will show you how and why you need access to a Docker Hub. You will see that when you create this kind of an image, you usually create it based on another one, and I will again explain what that means, making an analogy to what a class in Java looks like. So you will you will understand it pretty well, especially if you have used up to now an object-oriented language. So once you install the Docker, you might have also, depending on your operating system, you might install also a Visual Tool. I will use now the Visual Tool only to show you what happens, but I will teach you how to use Docker basically through the command line, because more often in a real world example, you will rather see Docker used within the command line in a continuous integration pipeline rather than a visual tool. So that's why I do recommend my students install the visual tool for Docker, but I do also recommend them start using and get used with the command line rather than using the tool, because in most cases they will find the commands more useful. And in this part of the stream, later in next episodes, when I will discuss Jenkins and the CI/CD, so continuous integration, continuous deployment, and continuous delivery, I will come back to you and I will remind you why you always need to learn the command line. You need to learn the command line of whatever tool you use, like Git. You need to use the command line to learn the command line of Docker. You need to learn the command line of Kubernetes. We'll discuss about Kubernetes in next episodes. All these tools, when you use them in real world examples, you'll more often use them from the command line rather than the GUI. You more likely use the GUI only when you learn things on your virtual, on your own machine. So that's why I will basically go to a command line, and what I want to do is check if my Docker runs well. So I installed Docker and I started it, and that's everything I've done. And I'm now checking what version do I have here installed. And if I have a reply from my Docker version command, then it means my Docker has successfully been installed and it runs. And you see, here I have all the information I need about the Docker version I installed on my computer. So being that this command works, it actually means that Docker is installed, seems to correctly be installed on my machine. So this is the first thing you need to do. You install Docker from the official website according to your operating system, and then you check with Docker version if it started, and if it replies to that command, it means at least that it seems to be working. So don't go further if that's not working, because nothing else it will work. So if Docker version is not working, then you have to check why. So that's the first thing you need to do. Now that I clarify that this works for me, if you simply write Docker, it should come with a list of commands that you can use. And I usually use this list to remember the commands when I forget them, because I don't have a memory of an elephant, and I do forget things when I don't use them for a long time. And trust me, I'm a developer and an architect, so I'm not a DevOps and neither an infrastructure guy, so I do forget things once in a while about Docker, Kubernetes, commands, and so on and so forth. So I do remember them by going and reading at least the short description. But the most important ones that you will need here as well are maybe running a container, which we will use here, removing a container and removing an image, building an image, which is the build here, which is basically the first one we will use. Let me clear it again. And what I want to do is in this demonstration, let's actually create an application and try to run it in our container, which is now installed directly on my machine. So being that I have it on my machine directly, not on a virtual machine, I can say that I have containers over bare metal here. But again, in a real world scenario, you will most likely have an infrastructure based on virtual machines, but that doesn't make any difference on what we will discuss here. So it's the same thing in terms of commands and the way it's working. It's just that you would run your Docker and containerized environment over the virtual machine instead of application, the system directly. So going back to what I want to do here before going into the image, I have my IntelliJ here and I want to create a new project. So let's create a new project. And I say Spring Initializer. I will create a small web application with an endpoint that returns a string. Very simple and easy to test, because if that's working, any web application would work. So that's a very simple demonstration of how you would deploy any web app in a container, which is a very often encountered scenario. So how do we call this? Software architecture, I don't even know what episode is this, so E something, sorry for that, I forgot it, maybe I can see here. So it's 19, says here, episode 19, E19. So I'm using Java version 11, I think it's just enough for our demonstration. We go here, I choose the web dependency, Spring Web, and I will create a very, very small, but let's move it directly in my documents. So documents, and say here SAE19, finish, create folder. So I have a question, so I see something in chat. Make a video on Gradle and Maven. I will in the future. Thank you very much for the suggestion. So how do I know so many things? Well, I basically forget a lot of them, don't worry. So I'm not, as I said, I don't have the memory of an elephant, but I do use the documentation a lot. What are bare metals? We call a bare metal the computer itself. So when you say I install something directly on the computer, it means that I install it on the bare metal, and it's called the bare metal because it's bare metal. So it's actually, being a Mac, it's actually metal. Sometimes it's plastic, but it's not bare plastic, we call it bare metal. So bare metal is seen directly on your computer. When you install something on your computer, we call it bare metal. Over the computer, you might have a virtualized environment. So you might have virtual machines on bare metal, and then that's one abstraction layer, as we discussed in the previous episode. And then containers directly, you can have them directly over the bare metal, as I have here. So I have containers directly installed on my Mac, but I could have had actually virtual machine inside my Mac, which was the virtual machine on bare metal, and containers inside the virtual machine. So yeah, a physical server is the bare metal, exactly as Ortail, I hope I pronounced correctly your name. Thank you very much. Exactly as you say there, so bare metal is directly the physical computer. A virtual machine is a virtual computer. So I was here creating a very, very small web application. For that, I only need to create a controller. And let me create a demo controller. And I say it's REST controller and public string demo returns demo. And then we have the get mapping here. So basically this is a REST endpoint. And in case my application works, then any application will work. So I'm pretty confident that this is a good demonstration for then any kind of web application would you deliver. Please touch on the key important things to consider when creating Java Docker files and images. Yes, I will. So let me just create the example for everyone. And then together with the example, I will discuss all this. So what I've done here, if I'm going back to my console, so I'm going to list what I have here. And one of the things I have here should be my, oh, it isn't here. I don't quite understand. I thought I created it inside. So documents SAE19, and then I have documents, strange essay. Okay, it's here, sorry, I just skip it somehow, but it's, oh, it's on the right side here, sorry. it's probably too tired at this this hour. So E19, okay, so I changed CD essay underline E19, my fault. I'm now in the E19, and then I do a list. And you can see here that I have my Maven project. So someone actually asked me about Maven. I will basically now compile this Maven project. You see, I have no target folder. So that's because I didn't compile it. So being a Maven, which is a build tool, and I promise I will take that in another episode, which is something related to more to development. But as an idea now, what you actually do when you have the source code of a Maven project, you do a Maven install. Maven install, if everything is all right, will create my target folder. And that target folder contains a jar file, which is my executable archive. So let me clear the screen. You see that the build was a success, of course, because we didn't have any reason not to be. But if I list again, you see that a new target folder appeared here. This target folder is basically the compiled and packed solution of my application. So if I'm basically listing the target folder contents, you will see that I have here the SAE19 something something jar file. This is the packed application. And you can easily see that if I run java minus jar target SA something something on my application, then what happens is that my application starts on the bare metal. So this is an application starting directly on my machine, which makes it starting on the bare metal. But what we want is not having it on the bare metal. What we want is make it start in a container, which is running in my computer over the bare metal. Yeah, you can basically test. Let's test it on the bare metal, see it's working here. So we have no problem afterwards. So it's localhost 8080 demo. We can see that it works. It indeed returns the string demo. That's what should have happened. And now let's close the application. And let's try to put this in a container. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going back to my IntelliJ. And in order to create containers in Docker, you need to have an image. There is no container created without an image, just because that's the way Docker works. The image for Docker is like the object for Java. You need to have an object defined to create instances. You can't have an instance without a prototype. Same here, you can't have a container without an image. The image is the prototype of the container. The container is the running environment. Keep that in mind. If someone asks you during an interview, that's what happens. So what I'm doing here, I will make sure that I create my image. To create an image, you need to write a Docker file. So let's write a Docker file that will help us declaratively explain Docker, how the environment should look like. And based on that Docker file, on our descriptive language, with Docker, we will compile it. It's codes compile, you don't really compile it, you build it. It's called the build of the image, but it's same as the compilation. Same as how you in Java write a class so that, and you compile it and you get the bytecode. Same here, you write Docker file, you build it, it becomes an image, and then based on the image, you spin up containers, you create the real environments, how many you'd like. So going here, I'm going to create a new file and I will call it a Docker file. And inside the Docker file, I will describe the environment in which I want to create and spin up, which is a simple, just a simple, I would like here, application running on a Java virtual machine inside a very, very small packed operating system. So what I will do is I'm going now to find an image that already has everything but my application and its configuration. And to find that image, I'm going to hub.docker.com, which is the Docker Hub, so-called Docker Hub. The Docker Hub contains images. You can create your own images here, or you can download open source images. For example, in my case, what I need is a distribution, a Java distribution that I can use to run this application of mine. So let's say I choose the .openjdk distribution. It's one of my favorites. Of course, you can choose the Oracle JDK if you'd like, but remember that the Oracle JDK in production is licensed, so you need to pay to Oracle to use that. Or you can use the Azul distribution, or you can use the OpenJDK distribution, whatever you'd like. Let's take Adopt. So I basically just searched here for Adopt JDK, and that's how I got on this page. Okay, and here you will see that you have a good description of the image, and it even tells you how you can create create your own image based on this one. So you see that it starts, let me copy it actually the way it is and change it in my IDE. So you can see that it starts with this row here, line one, from and the name of the Adobe JDK image that I took from Docker Hub. Now, this might be confusing for you, so let me explain it first. I want to start with this row and explain it, but to explain it now, you need to know how images work in Docker. So images are layered in Docker. I said that previously, but now I will explain it. So we have a base image, and then over a base image, you can create a second image. So you can just create a second image over the one that already exists. What does that mean? It means that the first image describes something, and then the second image that is created above that one adds more configuration to it. And then you can even create a third image and add even more configuration to it. And then you can create a fourth image, and that will add even more configuration. And basically you can do that as many times as you want. You can always use an existing image to make it more particular. So that's why any image is always based on another one that is based on another one that is based on another one. So that's why I need to write this first row here that is from and the image name. It means that I will customize my, this is my image. Say this is my image, the last one here. the green one, let's make it green. This is my image, the one I create. When I create it, I say I customize it starting from adopt OpenJDK. Okay? Which itself, the image, might be created based on another image, which might be created on another image, and so on and so forth. So basically, my customization here is I will take the adopt OpenJDK, which in my case will come with everything I need, including the Java virtual machine of the version I've chosen, 11 in this case. And then I will simply customize the environment, telling it above this, please add my jar file and run it, which is run my application over adopt OpenJDK. And if you want later, based on this image, you can even create another one. So you can, as like you, like I customize here the adopt OpenJDK in order to create some new image. The image I resulted, my the result of my Docker file can be furthermore customized later in another image. And keep in mind that these images, they are immutable. So that means once you created an image, you cannot change it. You can always create another one based on one an existing one, but you cannot change one that has been compiled, built based on a Docker file. So does a JDK version that is already in the system conflict with the Docker version? No, because basically the environment that will be created will be a unique independent environment of its own running on that virtual machine. If our application Spring Boot, what archive format we use, WAR or JAR, which is better? It's unrelated to the subject we discuss here, but Spring Boot is maybe 99 or 100% of the cases used as a jar, but let's take that in a separate video if you want, because it's totally unrelated to the subject. So now we discuss Docker. And now what I'm trying to do is, again, I'm trying to take the adopt OpenJDK and I'm creating my image. So this from, imagine this from is like extends in case of Java. When you write your own class, you say public class cat extends animal. What does that mean? If you have a bit of knowledge of Java, you know that means that you create a class cat which particularizes the class animal. So it takes the prototype defined by class animal and makes it more particular, usually by adding fields, methods, overriding methods. So customizing the animal. Cat is a customized animal. That is inheritance in Java and in general in an object-oriented language. This from here is basically like the inheritance in Java for the classes, but it's for images. So in my case, I say I'm creating an image by extending adopt OpenJDK and everything that exists in it. So I will create a new prototype, a new image, that it contains everything that comes from adopt OpenJDK. And then, of course, later in the next lines, I need to tell it what will you basically do, how would you particularize it, because if you leave it like this, then you basically have an image created over the adopt OpenJDK and nothing more. So it's the same, somehow the same image you create. It's just like writing public class cat extends animal and you don't write anything in the class cat. Then basically in terms of the prototype, cat and the animal are the same. So the next lines that you write here are to customize, to particularize, to say what you do further. How is this image different based on the one you inherit? And that's what we are trying to do here. So let's say this is app, and this is to be target slash and then I have to copy the name. This name is usually, in a real world example, would be customized to be smaller or more significative than mine, but I just kept the default. So that should be like this in my case. And I think I should actually name it Abjar. So I say copy from my local machine. When Docker builds it, I say copy from my local machine this jar file from the relative path target, which is basically this one here. Yeah, I'm in the target. I'm here, and in the target I have this jar file, and I say copy this one as being inside my operating system, which will run in the container. Remember that here it will come together with everything, and copy it named as abjar, and then run java minus jar and the location of the jar, which is basically what we did earlier on the bare metal. But now we do it inside the container. We tell Docker what will happen, what will Docker do when running this. So now that this is basically everything. Now, of course, you can configure a lot of things here. You can configure whatever you want in this environment. You can create files, you can, write in files, delete them, run multiple apps, do whatever you want here. For our scenario, I think it's enough to run a Java application to understand how this looks like. So this created my Docker file, which now is exactly here. If I list this, the Docker file is right here inside this folder. It's where I created it, near the target folder, inside where we have the jar file, the Java archive, the executable archive. So in order to build based on the Docker file, what I say is Docker build, I will give it a name like app. This is the name of the image, minus T is from tag actually, which is the name we give to our image. And then I say, and find the Docker file inside the current directory, which is a dot. Why command is separated by comma? I think that question is based on this syntax here. Well, basically this is the descriptive language, which in case of the command instruction, it has the command with the parameters representing the name of the process, followed by, separated by comma, all the parameters. So we say Java and then enumerated all the parameters. That's how the syntax is designed. So what is the difference between run and command? Well, basically command is actually saying that you run a command in the command line of the environment. That's what we do. Instead here we say just run the command itself. I'm not sure if it actually, I could have used both of them. In this case, I just copied what I got. I just copy pasted what I got from the Docker Hub and they were like this. But most likely here, you would like to use variables sometimes. And that's, I think it's not possible with this one. I might be wrong because again, I'm not an expert in infrastructure, but I'm pretty sure that you can use variables here because I've used them. So maybe that's why you most likely use the command here. That's why it looks like this one. But in my case here, I most likely could have used both of them. And in my case here, the way it looks like is just because I copied it the way it was on Docker Hub. It's not because I meant it for some reason to be this way. I hope I answered your question. So now basically being here, I say Docker build an app named app using the Docker file in the current directory. And we wait. What will happen here is that Docker will download all the layers needed. So it will download all the images. Basically for mine, it will find it needs to download this one. And then if this one is based on some other one that I don't have already locally, it will download that one and others too, basically will download every information it needs, and that happens only the first time when you run the command, because then later you will already have everything in downloaded on your computer. And that's again a very smart thing, because what means is that Docker only needs once to download all the information. Afterwards, it only needs to use what either already exists and change or recreate or download only what's missing. So that's how it basically improves a lot the performance of building the app, because instead of having to run your instead of having to download everything again and again and again, you basically already have from the first time everything locally, and then you get only and you only need to get what's new. So that's why here, for example, in my case, because I've most likely already used previously this image in other examples and demonstrations, I already had it, so it didn't have to actually download it, because it was already on my machine. So it was quite fast, and the build was absolutely fast. It was almost instantaneous because of that. If I would probably change this image with one that I don't have, then it will take a little bit more, because it will first need to download them, because they will not be locally yet on my machine. Anyway, I've been build the image. So if I'm going here, less than a minute ago, the graphical interface of Docker shows me that I created an image that's 261 megabytes, and it's called app. So basically, that's why I've kept the UI, because I wanted to compare it with the console to see that what I'm doing in the console also reflects here. So now, basically, if I want to see the image in the console, I would say Docker images. And Docker images shows me that I have only one image created 2 minutes ago, the same size you see in the UI, the same image ID you see in the UI. And if I want to see the environments I have running in this Docker, which are the containers created based on this image, I would run Docker PS. And I see that I have no container running. Is it possible to download? Oh, you're reading. Okay. So anyway, so what I'm doing here is I will try now to spin up one container. So how do we spin it up? We basically use Docker run, and basically I will have to say that my application exposes a port, because if I want it to be accessible from inside, If I run it like this one, I will basically not be able to access what's inside. So maybe I should do that to show you. Let me show you. So I would say just Docker run app. Oops. And you see the container is now running. This is basically inside the container now. And you see that my application started inside the container, because that's what actually app was designed to do, start my application inside the container. And then you see that the application exposes port 8080. But if I'm going in my browser and test this, it will show nothing, because being inside the container, my browser doesn't actually have access. It expects now, because I said localhost 8080, it expects now that my application is directly running on the local computer. So how can we make our application expose the port outside? Well, first of all, I will need to close this container. So now I will say Docker remove the image app. I want to remove the image. It tells me that I can't remove the image, because I have a container which, even if it's not running, it's based on this image. So you cannot have an instance of the class without the class. So that what does that mean is that we need to remove the container first so that we can remove the image. So let's say Docker remove the container. We remove the container, and then we remove the image, and that worked. You can go to the GUI, you see there is no image anymore. You can go and say Docker images again, you see there is no image anymore. And then what we will do is that we will change first here and say expose 8080, which is the port that our application will open. We know that our application opens port 8080. That's first thing I need to do. And secondly, now after I will recreate the image, so let me recreate the image. Okay, I recreated the image. I have it again here, it says six minutes ago, but I am totally sure that this is a bug because it's a recreated image. And I'm actually curious if I say Docker images. It actually shows the same, but basically it's a new image created, trust me. So it means that it simply has a cache or something. But the idea is the same. Now I just say Docker run minus minus publish 8080 port inside the container into 8080 port to be matched to outside the container, and then run the image app. And what I'm doing now, I'm running again the container. I just created a new container and I see that my application started port 8080, but the difference now is that when I'm going here, you will be able to access it. So unlike the other case where you saw that it didn't work, now it works because the port has been published from inside to outside the container. And that's basically your application running in a container. And you can actually have as many containers as you would like. So if I want now to spin up two containers with the same application, I can basically do that by rerunning the same Docker command. So I can basically create as many containers. I can spin up as many environments as I want just by running the commands based on the image I created, which is described based on something. So you see how easy it is to create environments in a containerized solution. And that's because you rely on something that already exists, and you only have to customize creating your own image with exactly what you'd like in it, like in my case, the app itself. Tell your environment how it would look like, and then you can add it, create it, remove it, spin it up as many times as you'd like. Very easy. So let me see what questions do I have. Is it possible to download custom jar from our own repositories like Nexus? I need to embed some custom jar. Yeah, that's not really a difference, isn't it? So it's basically a lot like what I did here, just that in my case the jar was from my local computer, but nothing keeps you to download it from a repository. You can just use a command to take it from your repository and put it same as I did in my Docker file. Of course you can do that. I don't have permission to install Docker on my company Windows laptop. Can you suggest some alternative? That's a good one. I'm not sure, basically, if you can't install Docker, but you can install a virtual machine, an idea would be to install the Docker inside the virtual machine. That's possible. If that's not possible either, then I don't have a solution for you, because you need to have actually root permissions to be able to install your virtualization solution or Docker. Otherwise you can't do that. So sorry, you need to use a computer that has enough permissions to do that. Install your own personal laptop, or you can use Podman. Okay, that could be a solution. I didn't use that one before, so maybe I will note that down. Thank you very much. I also learned things. So how do you say Podman? Okay, thank you. And now, Docker consume much RAM. I'm assuming if you have many containers, you will need more memory to run asynchronously. Of course, you need basically to have enough resources, but that's based on your infrastructure design. So when you actually use Docker in a real world environment, you don't use it like I do it on my machine. You basically have virtualized solution, an infrastructure that is configured. You need to have provided with enough memory depending on what you are running. You need to have memory for the Docker itself, as well as for the applications running in your containers. So of course, if you are running 10 containers, then you will need to have enough containers and in enough resources to run your containers. And in the next episode, I will discuss actually orchestration of containers using a very nice tool that I like, and it's called Kubernetes. You might have heard about Kubernetes. You will see that you basically can provide different limitations to your containers, and you can even orchestrate those limitations you give to your containers. And I will explain more about limitations for containers when I discuss the orchestration of containers in the next episode, more likely. But yes, I do agree with you. One of the, we can put it on the list of disadvantages. The more you go upper in the abstraction layer stack, the more, first of all, we know that the less flexible we are. Secondly, we know that we need more resources for our tools to run, because now I'm showing you Docker. In the next episode, besides Docker, I will show you Kubernetes. Guess what? Kubernetes consumes resources. So yes, you need your virtual machines even more resources, because you now want to run not only Docker, but also Kubernetes. So that's basically part of the disadvantages. And that's excellent that you thought about that, because that's the way a software architect should think about. When you think about the architecture of your application and the tools you use to deploy, the process you use to build the application, everything that's part of this process is software architecture. And that's what you need to think about. Do I need, what do I want to do? I want to deploy my application. How do I want to deploy it? And then you have to choose. Is it a virtual machine or is it a container? Is it both of them maybe, depending on how big your system is and how the components work? Do I need to also use serverless? Let's try to answer these questions in the next episode, now that you have the awareness already more of what Docker is. You can replicate this yourself, and I do advise you try yourself to create your own image and see that you can do that, and try to understand the relationship between the Docker file, the image, and the container. And then let's discuss, take some examples. I will provide you some example, and I will say we have this system doing that, looking this way. Where do we deploy it? In a virtual machine, in a container, in both solutions? Do we need serverless or not? And let's see how can we use this kind of a case, study case, and see what is your solution, what would you choose, why, and discuss the alternatives. Let's do that in the next episode, so that we have enough time. And then once we finish with the study case, we will start discussing orchestration of containers. And I will show you again this tool that I really like, Kubernetes. You might have heard about it. And I will show you why Kubernetes is so much appreciated nowadays, and how should you work and where should you use Kubernetes, of course. Do I have many other questions? Say, can I use JVisual VM to still monitor my web app even after putting my app inside the Docker? Excellent question. Again, the answer is yes, you can do that. And that's basically one of the subjects I'm tackling in one of my next books that I have already started, will be about debugging and using and profiling apps in general, investigating code. And yes, you can use JVisual VM to monitor what's inside the container, as long as you have the right configuration exposing the ports you need, of course. So you need, if you want to remote debug inside the container or use the container remote profile inside of a container, you can do that, but you need to have the right ports exposed, like I did here. For example, when I wanted to access port 8080, I had first to make sure that I published that port, so before being able to access it. So the same you would have to do with the ports that need to be accessed by your remote profiling tool or the remote debugging tool. Excellent question. So And that's very easy, creating a container, and I hope you enjoyed it. We don't stop here with Dockers and container. I will continue the discussion next time with a study case, and then we will go into Kubernetes. And in the end, the purpose is that you can understand the relationship between the apps you implement and how should you deploy them. And I will make sure that you properly understand them, and never consider, as I said also earlier, that virtual machines and containers, that containers are better than virtual machine or the other way around, because sometimes developers make confusion on that, but that's not the case. And again, explaining you with examples, I will make sure that I make that relevant and you understand why. Logging is not a problem. So super. With that being said, time is up, and I've been very efficient in precisely 1 hour explaining you how this works. I hope you again enjoyed the video, and I hope to see you again in the next episode. Up to that point, thank you very much again for being here with me and for all your questions and discussions, and have an excellent time for study further. Cheers and bye-bye.